So we have already seen that, so some of these slides are repeated because the last lecture was a little rushed. I decided we'll do another pass where we will go through things which are clear relatively quickly, and then I will dwell a little more on things which are not clear. Okay. So some of this basic stuff should be okay by now. In decimal, you write down decimal numbers and then you can increment it. First you increment the unit place. If that overflows, you carry over to the tens place and so on. Binary is exactly the same. So suppose we have 8-bit binary numbers. Those look like values between 0000000 through 8 ones. And you clock up from the smallest value of all zeros in steps of 1. The very next value is going to be all zeros followed by a 1 in the rightmost position. That is one decimal. And then when you try to increment it again, the so-called binary unit position overflows here. And then you carry over to the tens or twos position in binary. That is equal to 2 decimal. If you increment it again, the lowest significant bit or LSB, that is increased to 1, that's a 3. Then both of these overflow. So the next number is 4, which is 100, and so on. So there's nothing profound about it. With a little practice, you can read binary numbers fairly easily. So you keep doing that until you end up in the last number, which is 11111111. If you try to increment that again, the overflow bit disappears from the left and you roll back to 00000000. So 255 is followed by 1, by 0. That is one way to look at it. That will give you only non-negative numbers, 0 and the positive numbers. And that's a little bit of a problem because we also want negative numbers. And that is implemented through what's called two's complement arithmetic. Positive numbers, you go from the pattern of all zeros as decimal 0 to the pattern of all ones, which is 255. Okay, that will be the range of positive numbers. If you want negative numbers, the two's complement representation is that you go to the last positive number, which is the last number with 0 in the leading position, which happens to be 127. And what used to be plus 128 is now no longer a positive number. So those things are gone. What happens is you come back to the next number, which is 1 followed by all zeros. That becomes minus 128. Okay, so the wraparound changes, and then you start incrementing again until you go to minus 1, which happens to be the pattern of all ones. Okay. So what used to be a wraparound from the largest positive value of 255 back to 0 has now shifted. Now the wraparound happens from 127 to minus 128, and minus 1 to 0 is not really a wraparound, it's just the next value. Okay. So that's 2's complement arithmetic. Now before getting into longer word representations, let's look at what a character means. Okay. In standard C and C++, a character is really a single byte. So to a first approximation, a character is the same as a byte. Internally, it's exactly the same. It's 8 bits. The only difference is how the compiler and the system interprets what to do with it. Okay. So you can easily declare, so when you say character variable A equals 65, that's a declaration. Okay. This 65 is an integer which is stored in this VA, which has, you know, 8 bits. But when you print it out, because the type of VA is character, that 65 is interpreted as a code for the letter A, capital A. So all the letters, uppercase, lowercase, digits, punctuations, brackets, they have all been assigned unique IDs between 0 and 255. So you could either write character VA equal to 65, or you could also write character VA equals single quote A. they mean exactly the same thing. Okay. Now, if you write out VA, this will print A to screen, because the assumption is that you want to print the character's representation. If you'd rather write out the code, then you have to write out something a little different. You have to say, sorry. You have to cast it to an int. This is called a cast. And this tells the compiler that the user wants to see the integer representation, not the printable character representation. Then 65 will be printed. Now, C++ will also let you compare characters based on their corresponding integers. So, small a is less than small b. It's one less. Okay. Meanwhile, capital A is less than capital D. So, that ordering is there. But between uppercase and lowercase, it's an arbitrary convention, whether uppercases are bigger or lowercases are bigger integers. You can't depend on that. Okay. Unless you know the whole sequence of assignments between characters and 8-bit integers. So, that's what a character is. And another way of printing these numbers to be unambiguous is the hexadecimal code, which we already discussed last time. 8 bits is equal to 2 blocks of 4 bits each. A 4-bit block can represent values between 0 and 15. And instead of printing 10, 11 through 15, those are turned into single character digits. That's called the base 16 system. So, base 10, you go from 0 through 9. Base 16, you go from 0 through 15, but 10 through 15 are written as A, B, C, D, E, F. That makes it easy to print these numbers in fixed format lengths. For example, every byte now becomes 2 hex digits. So, 2, 3 hex is 2 times 16 plus 3. Okay? C, 5 hex is C times 16 plus 5. Same as the decimal type system. It's only the base or radix has changed. To disambiguate this to the compiler, when you are writing the code, you have to write hexadecimal numbers prefixed with 0x, so that the compiler knows it's not decimal. It is to the base of 16. Okay? And we have seen a printf demo showing this. So, we have now covered bytes and characters. Bytes are the internal representation. In C, there is no byte data type. In Java, they made a byte data type to make this distinction clear, because in Java, a character is not necessarily one byte. To support all the international languages, the character was made possibly wider. Okay. We won't go into that. Now, what is the reason that you'd like to compare characters? Why is it useful that A is less than B? The reason is that when we construct strings like hello world out of characters, and I give you a whole list of strings starting from Amir Khan to Zanzibar, you can now sort them in some dictionary order. And then you can search these lists to go to the right word or the right phrase quickly. And that's very, very useful in database applications. So that's why characters have an underlying ordering on them as well, so that we can then order strings. Now, we also discussed that only one byte with values between 0 and 255 or between minus 128 and 127 may be too short a range, and for most applications you will need integers with larger capacity. And that's why the language provides short and int and long int. Those are 16, 32 and 64 bits respectively. And those are organized in RAM in multiples of bytes, fixed series of bytes. And usually most architectures will insist that if you are storing a 2-bit short, then the first, sorry, 2-byte short, the first byte has to be at an even address. Okay. If you are putting down a 4-byte integer in RAM, many architectures for simplicity of addressing will insist that the first byte starts at an address which is a multiple of 4. There are some small details like that, but it's not too important for our understanding. So, all we need to understand is that a fixed length memory buffer of length 4 bytes is reserved to store an integer. And you may read the integers, for example, this may be the least significant bit, and then you keep wrapping around until you end up at the most significant bit over here. Okay. So that's the way multi-byte integers are stored in RAM. But they're still fixed sizes. The size doesn't change. Okay. And that's why these integers have what is called fixed precision. There is a fixed range of values you can represent. If you walk out of that, you'd wrap around. Either way. You take a very negative number, try to make it more negative, you will shoot up to a positive number. You take a very positive number, you try to increase it further, you go back to a negative number. You may wrap multiple times. In one of the labs, one exercise was initialize an integer to 40,000, which is larger than the largest signed short, which is 32767. And then if you assign it to a short, you get a negative number, because 40,000 wrapped on 32767 will result in a negative number. But now if you initialize the original integer to 400,000 and then you assign it to the short, you will actually logically wrap around multiple times. You still end up with a positive number, but that number is not, of course, 400,000, which a short cannot represent. Real numbers are represented very similar to decimal, very similar to how you'd write scientific numbers in decimal, scientific notation. It's a mantissa times 10 to the power an integer exponent. So both the mantissa and the exponent are turned into binary code. The exponent is either a positive or a negative integer, so that's represented as 2's complement, using 8 bits in case of float and 11 bits in case of double. And the mantissa is a positive fraction, and we saw that just like there could be a decimal fraction, 0.123, you can have a binary fraction, 0.1001. Okay. And the value of a position goes like half, 1/4, 1/8, 1/16. Okay. So the more bits you have, the finer grained number you can represent. So in a float, the mantissa occupies 23 bits, and in a double, the mantissa occupies 52 bits. And then the overall number is either positive or negative. So for that, we reserve one signed bit. So if you do the calculations, you'll see that floats can go between this range of maximum and minimum magnitude apart from the sign. And double can go between a much larger range. So you can represent many, many more numbers using double, but definitely not all real numbers. So in one of the labs as well as in class, I mentioned that you need care because all real numbers cannot be represented. Okay. In particular, if your code depends on two real numbers being equal, okay, some of you have already seen it in the labs. You cannot really depend on them as being exactly equal. When you declare two floating point variables, say FA and FB, and you ask, is FA exactly equal to FB? That's really bit for bit equality. Depending on numeric imprecision, you may well end up doing mathematically equivalent calculations on them and yet end up with a few different bits because of finite precision. So in most cases, if you want reliable code and you are comparing floating point numbers, you have to compare them within some epsilon window of each other. Otherwise, your code might misbehave in unexpected ways. Other issues about finite precision in floating point numbers is in this special values of infinity, minus infinity, and NaN. So typically, overflowing to infinity is handled fairly well by all the programming systems. But if you have a very large number and you are adding or subtracting a very small number, you can lose precision. The small number may have no effect because that difference fell off the edge of the mantissa bits. So if you have a calculation where you are adding a huge number of small numbers and the sum is, however, non-negligible, you need to do the addition in the correct order so that your result is as close as possible to the correct value. Okay. So now I wanted to be a little more methodical about what all you can do with numeric types, what kind of operations are allowed on them. So all the integers support plus, binary, minus, also unary minus. You can get 5 and say minus 5. Okay. Multiplication, which is a star, slash, which is division, and percent, which is remainder. So I divide 7 by 3, you know, I get some remainder. Okay. Even the characters support plus and minus. So because characters are fundamentally integers, byte integers inside, you can also do basic arithmetic operation on them. It may not make sense to multiply characters in that sense, but in any system, quote A plus 1 is quote B. But what is quote Z plus 1? Okay. So let's try this. okay. And now I'll print, by the way, to avoid confusion about what is being printed, perhaps we can write things like, you know, CA equals followed by the actual value of CA. Okay. The first is a string, it says CA equal to, that's exactly what will be printed. The second is the actual value of CA. And then we'll say what is CB. So the next character after capital Z is the open box bracket in the assignment of characters to codes. And there are tables available on the web, you can easily find this out. Okay. So that's that, you can compare characters, you can increment characters, but you don't know where exactly you land. The lowercase and the uppercase characters are assigned contiguous sequences to make comparison easy. Okay. So you can always, they are contiguous, but A is not 1 or anything like that. Okay. Meanwhile, the other thing to observe is that 0 through 9 are not 0 through 9, obviously. So the character 0 is very different from the integer 0. Yeah, so this will not work because it's printing the character itself, right? So I said that to print the corresponding code, you have to cast it to an integer. So we'll talk about casts in more detail later. But the code for 0 is 48 decimal. All right, so what else can we do with numeric types? Float and double support the usual plus, minus, multiply, divide as well. And more complicated operations on floating point numbers like log or exponential or sine, cosine, etc. are implemented as functions in a library. There are no native symbols for that. You call a function, you get a return. We'll discuss functions in the next week or the week after that. You can also compare numbers using what are called comparison or relational operators. So you can check if A is less than B, A is less than equal to B, A is equal to B, and this equal to is a comparison. So we need a different symbol as compared to assignment. Assignment uses the single equal sign. Comparison uses two equals. And it's relatively easy to get it wrong while you are typing, so be careful about that, especially if you are using the comparison operator. Single equal you type, two equals you might miss. So when you are comparing things, be careful to type it. Or greater than equal to or not equal to. So those are the basic comparison operators. And the result of a comparison between two numbers is a Boolean value. A Boolean value is either 0 or 1. We'll discuss it right next. But inside C and C++, there is no distinct Boolean type. So those systems use integers to overload the use of Booleans. And there are some associated glitches with that. So the convention is not that 0 is false and 1 is true. The convention is 0 is false and anything else is true. Okay. And that's a kind of a mess, apart from collapsing the two types, because you can write strange expressions like if 5 then do something, and 5 is true and so is minus 1. Okay. So you compute Boolean values by expressions like this. You say 5 greater than 7 and you bracket it to make sure that 5 is not printed by accident. And 5 greater than 7 is a Boolean expression with value false or 0. So if you write this, cout will print 0. Okay. Whereas 4 is indeed not equal to 3, and so that the value of that expression will be 1. So in this case, cout will print 1. So this we have seen, some of you have seen it in the labs. So for those of you who are not familiar with Boolean algebra, a very quick refresher is that there are two values in Boolean algebra, true and false, 0 and 1. And you can combine values. There are rules, functions for combining. The AND function is what you would expect. Both the inputs have to be true or 1 for the output to be 1. The OR function again is what you would expect. At least one of the inputs have to be 1 for the output to be 1. Okay. One important thing to remember in this is that C and C++ will do what's called short circuit evaluation. Okay. So if you say that, you know, evaluate the expression A and B, and A is found to be false, there is no further any need to evaluate B because the answer is already known to be false. So for efficiency, the compiler will not even, you know, arranged to evaluate B. Similarly, if you say if A or B and A is found to be true, then the expression is already true no matter what B is. So in that case again B will not be evaluated. So short circuit evaluation is efficient because it avoids the evaluation of expressions that are not required to find the value, but it has an unfortunate side effect in that if evaluation of some of the expressions were to change the state of memory, and we can do that with function calls, then you have to be very careful about understanding the nature of the code. We'll see that when we discuss increments and decrements on integers. So remember that Boolean expressions are evaluated in the most efficient way possible, and not all parts of the expression will even be evaluated to find the output if possible. There is also the unary operation called NOT, and there if the input is 0, the output is 1, if the input is 1, the output is 0. There is also the binary operation called XOR. So what XOR is defined as exactly one of the inputs has to be 1. If both of them are 1, then unlike OR, in XOR the answer is 0. XOR is useful for many things as we shall see. Okay. Now, you can do logical operations. So there are two classes of operations in C++. One is with Boolean conditions, the other is with arrays of bits. These are slightly different. So one Boolean condition is say 5 greater than 7. So the value of this is false. Then there is 3 not equal to 4, the value of that is true. I can now combine them by logical AND, okay, which is represented by 2 ampersands. So that will read like 5 greater than 7 and 3 not equal to 4, right. So this is false, this is true, the overall value of this is false. In fact, if you write an expression like this, the compiler will arrange that this is never evaluated. That's AND. Similarly, you have the logical OR operator. This time, by convention, you go from left to right. You evaluate the first one, you find that to be false. But for OR, there is still hope. So you have to continue with the second expression. Evaluate that, you find this is true, the overall value of this is true or 1. Okay. Similarly, there is the NOT operator. So you can put a condition inside NOT, and that has the semantics of unary NOT. Okay. So these Boolean conditions or logical operators are used for conditional execution of statements, for looping and program control. But there is an independent set of operations on arrays of bits, by which I mean if you look at say an integer, that is 32 bits. Each of them is capable of representing a Boolean value, 0 or 1. So C++ also supports bitwise operations between two such vectors or even one such vector. Okay. So suppose I have two nibbles for writing simplicity, say 0101. And 1011. I can AND them together using a single AND ampersand, and this would give me the logical AND of those two things. So 1 and 1 is 1, 1 and 0 is 0, all the others would be zeros. That's a logical AND. If I instead OR it, I'm going to get 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, that is the, those are some of the bitwise operators. So I can do A. So in this case, if I take two bit arrays and I say AND them together, what I mean is AND every bit position. So this bit is this and this, this bit is this and that, independently. So you get like a parallel execution for 8, 16, 32 or 64. So in this case, to distinguish it from the logical condition of AND, a single ampersand is used, a single bar is used for A or B. There is also an XOR operator and there is a NOT operator which is twiddle. So as you can see in this example, if you start with 10110110 and the following number, by ANDing it, you get a 0 in this position, you get a 0 in this position, you get 0 anywhere that both of them are not 1s. Meanwhile, if you OR them, the same two numbers, you will get a 1 where any of them used to be 1s. Okay. XOR will have a 1 where they were different. If they are the same, you get a 0. If they are different, you get a 1. And NOT or tilde or twiddle, that just inverts the bits. Wherever there was 0, you get a 1, wherever there was a 1, you get a 0. Right? So those are the basic bit array manipulations, but you can also do what is called bit shifts. Okay, so what's a shift? So if I declare integer C to have value 5, if you write down 5 in binary for 32 bits, 32 bits is 4 bytes. I have put commas just to show the byte boundaries. The last byte has value 5 and all the leading bytes are zeros. That is the integer 5 written in binary. Okay. Now I say take C and shift it left by 2 positions. Okay. It's really unfortunate of the C++ language to keep using the same symbols for multiple purposes. It's kind of confusing. Java has avoided it in most part. So what happens is that I am saying shift C left through 2 positions. So 2 zeros are injected from the left, sorry, from the right. Okay. And the leading 2 zeros pop off and disappear. Okay. So bits lost from the left or the most significant bit side, 0 bits injected from the right or the least significant bit side. And the result is, so if this is binary, that means this has weight 1, 2, 4, 8, 16. So it's 16 plus 4, the answer is 20. And why is it 20? Because I shifted it left by 2 positions, which implies a multiplication by 4. Okay. If you take a decimal number and shift it left by 1 position, you are multiplying it by 10. If you take a binary number and shift it left, you are multiplying it by 2. If you shift it twice, you multiply it by 4. Okay. So this is a cheap way to multiply numbers by powers of 2, much faster in hardware. Of course, you can also do right shifts, and right shifts will be C right shift by 2 positions. In this case, bits will be discarded to the right, but the left rule is a little different. If originally the most significant bit of C was 0, then 0 bits will be injected. If the original integer had 1 in the most significant bit, then according to 2's complement convention, the original number was negative. This time, the bits injected from the left will be 1s. And the reason for doing that is to preserve the sign of the number. If you are saying I want to divide minus 52 by 4, you expect a negative number. So that's why, depending on the original most significant bit, the same bit is injected from the left. Okay. And this is another benefit of using 2's complement. You can only check the first bit to decide if the number is negative or positive, and then do arithmetic accordingly. So minus 5 shifted right by 2 positions gives minus 2. Because minus 5, if you write it down in hex, is FFFFFFB. Okay. And you shift it right by 2 positions, you get FFFFFFFE. Okay. So let's try to remember that. So what is minus 5? First of all, what is plus 5? Plus 5 is 101 in the last nibble, 0101, right? And then the others were all zeros, correct? All the other bits were zeros. The last 4 bits were 0101. So that is 1, 4, that was 5. So how do I write it in hex? Remember, in hex, I always need this table because I can't never remember. So 10 is A, 11 is B, 12 is C. Is F, and A is also 1010 1011 1100 1101. So that's the table of the last 6 values. So this one is just 5, and then everything else is 0. 1 byte, 2 byte, 3 bytes, 4 bytes. That is 5 decimal written in hex. So now to find minus 5, what do I have to do? I have to first invert the bits and then add 1 in 2's complement. So if I invert the bits, what happens? The complement of 0 is F. So I get FF, 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 and what happens to this? This becomes 1, 0, 1, 0. And then I add 1 to it. Luckily, it doesn't overflow. And I get 1, 0, 1, 1. Okay, remember the rule for 2's complement. To take a number and find its negative, you invert all the bits and then you add 1 to it. And 1011 is that, B. So this becomes FB. Okay. 5-1 switching becomes 1010, plus 1 doesn't overflow. So that first 0 goes to F, the 5 goes to B. So minus 5, the hex code is all F's followed by a B, right? And now let's write it down again in that form. So I have, you know, I'll do a hybrid just to shorten the amount of writing I have to do. So this will be F, and then the B part I'll write down as 1011. Now if I start shifting this right by 2 positions, what happens is that these 2 drop off. And 2 bits are injected from the left, but there will be F's anyway because the original leftmost bit was 1, right? So what I'll end up with is, let me break this open so that all the bits are visible again. The last 4 bits is going to be 1110 because 1's from F flowed in as it was shifted, and then 1's also flowed in from the left, right? So this is the last nibble, then rest of it was F and FF and FF and FF. Okay. And what is 1110? That is E. So my result, so minus 5 shifted right by 2 is equal to FF, 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 FE. Which, if you look up your tables, will turn out to be minus 2. Why is it minus 2? This is equal to minus 2 decimal because the next number is FF, which is minus 1 decimal. After all F's, we drop around to 0. So the summary is that this form of right shifts with signed bit injection from the left will correctly give you division by powers of 2. But you of course lose the fractions because these are not fractional numbers. So there are many applications of bit operations. Okay. For example, to test if an integer is odd or even. So to test if a number is odd or even, all you have to do is to bitwise AND it with 1, right? So this 1 value in binary will look like all zeros followed by a 1. And I am ANDing it with my original number. So if the original number was odd, its last bit was 1. And the result of this AND is 1. Whereas if the original number was even, then its last bit was 0. And this ANDing will result in a 0. So is odd, which is a Boolean variable really, will turn out to be 0. Test if a number is odd or even, all you have to do is a bitwise AND with 1. So for example, 4 bits, the number 5 decimal is 0101, and I take 1, which is just that, I AND them together I get that. And so yes, 5 decimal is odd. Whereas I take something like say 6 decimal, which is 0110, it's 2 plus 4, and then I take my same what's called a stencil of 1, I add this together, what do I get? I get all zeros, so this is even. So, okay, now what do you, how to find the remainder when a number is divided by 8? So you could always say x percent 8. X percent 8 gives the remainder when a number is divided by 8. But an easier way to find it would be to say x and 7. Okay, so why is that? So let's take the number say, I don't know, 11 decimal. What is 11 decimal? 11 decimal should be 1011. So that is 8 plus 2, 10 plus 1, 11. Okay. Now 11, when you divide 11 by 8, the remainder is 3. Instead, I can take 7 decimal, which is 0111, and I add it together. Okay, so I have 1100, and this is 3. So whenever you are dividing a number by a power of 2 and you want to find the remainder, it's much faster and simpler to actually do an AND with the divisor minus 1. So 8 minus 1, 7. And these things are very useful when writing system programs, because you know, why do you think the number of bits in a fixed length integer go between 8, 16, 32 and 64? They are all powers of 2. Your file system is organized, you know, your files are allocated in units of blocks, and those are very often powers of 2, almost always. So file blocks are usually 512 bytes or 4096 bytes. And the entire reason is that you can do addressing very quickly by doing this bit operations. So the next example is a little more involved. Suppose you want to count the number of 1 bits in a 32 bit integer. How do you do that? Well, checking if a number is odd or even amounts to counting the number of 1s in the least significant position. And we also know how to shift numbers. So given these two, we should be able to do it. So we repeat 32 times. You can go from either end really. We can say, we can initialize a variable called number of 1s to 0. And then you say num 1s equals num 1s plus x and 8 followed by all zeros in hex. If you write down 8, 0, 0, etc. in hex, you will realize it's nothing but 1 bit followed by all 0 bits. Okay. So I am stenciling the original number's most significant bit with a 1. If that is 1, I am clocking up num 1s and then I shift it. Okay, so keep shifting and ANDing. So let's see an example of that. So suppose I was told to count the number of 1s in the number 1011. Okay. So what I do is I take this number, I stencil it with 8 unsigned, and this gives me a non-zero number, right? So this is not equal to 0. Therefore, I chalk up 1. Okay. Then I shift the original number left. I have already dealt with this bit now. I have figured out if this bit was 0 or 1. So now I shift it left. I get 0110. I again stencil it with the same number. And this time I get all zeros. So I don't do anything. Then I shift the number again. I get 1100. I stencil it again. Yes, I get a 1, non-zero. Then I shift the number again to get that. Now, this 1 has now shifted to the left. This time I again get a 1, so I get another 1. Okay. So of the 4 cycles in this execution, I get non-zero thrice, and so I count this up, and 3 is the number of bits in the original number. Okay. Now, so this is of course tedious to do. If I had to write down this code 32 times for integers and 64 times for longs, that's just painful coding. So that's why you use loops. Okay, many of you are familiar with it already. We'll cover loops very soon. So if I had to write down on the board, you know, I will try to lecture slowly and clearly. Doing that 108 times is painful. So I'll write a for loop for that. So that's how bit operations work. So let's look at a small demo of bit shifts to see some other subtle points. All right. So see, it's no fun doing bit operations without being able to show bits. For reasons unknown, it turns out that standard C++ has no way to directly print a number in binary format. This is very, very weird. So I wrote a couple of functions to print unsigned characters and integers in binary. How they work, we'll see very soon with loops and so on. But let's now focus only on the main method. Okay. So I initialize unsigned character A to 45. Well, let's go to that one next. Let's do this. So I have an integer C, sorry, and then I read C from the input, and then I just print out C both as decimal as well as in binary. So into binary C just prints C out in binary. And then I right shift C by 2 positions, and then I print out D in binary and D in decimal. It's a very simple piece of code. So I do that, and suppose I enter say 6. So remember, I'm shifting by 2 positions, so I'm dividing by 4. Okay. So 6 in binary as an integer, this is 32 bits, was 110, this is 2 plus 4. Okay. And when I divide it by 4, that's equivalent to shifting it right 2 positions. So the 0 and the 1 drop off, and only that last one comes here. And that's just 1. And so 6 divided by 4 is 1 when you drop fractions. Okay. But if I do this and I enter say minus 6. Okay, let's enter something a little more interesting, minus 12, say. Okay. What was happening there? I didn't get, okay, so minus 12 divided by 4 is minus 3. Right? So minus 12 is one, you know, all 1s followed by 0, 1, 0, 0. You can verify that. And as you can see, the shift just drops these 2 zeros, and this 1, 0, 1 pattern is to the right, and that is minus 3. Let's try a couple of more things. Suppose I enter minus 13. Minus 13 divided by 4 has become minus 4, whereas plus 13 divided by 4 is 3. Okay, this is a little unintuitive. So the explanation is that this is not symmetric about 0. We are following bit shifts and 2's complement convention, and this is the result. So you need to be a little careful about that. Okay, don't assume that truncating results of divisions goes the same for positive and negative numbers. It doesn't. Okay. So that's how right bit shifts work. Now let's look at the first part of the code. So all this code is available in the website. You should start with this and fool around and change a few things and see how it works. Oops. Okay, in this case, we are reading an unsigned character. This is not an int. Okay. And then we print A in binary, byte to binary, because a character is a byte. And then we left shift A 2 positions and we print it. Okay. and then I'll do some, you know, bit stenciling operations to see what it looks like. Fair enough? So, okay. So first, 45 is this quantity. It is 1 plus 4, that is 5, plus 8 plus 32. So this is 45. If I shift it left by 2 positions, what I get is 1 in the biggest position, and then, you know, 1011 coming from here, and then 01, and then 2 zeros have been injected from the left. Okay. So observe that in doing so, as a signed number, A would have changed from positive to negative. As an unsigned number, it may not. Okay. So let's verify that. So suppose instead of binary, we print this out as A, and then as A shifted left 2, all in binary, all in decimal, sorry, okay, not in. Okay, what happens in the first case? First case, A is interpreted as a character, and the corresponding code for 45 is the minus sign. So printing A is the same as printing the minus sign. If I wanted to get the code for A, I have to cast it. If I cast it, then I get 45. Okay. Now, as an unsigned integer, this quantity is 180. So on shifting, I get 180. But if this were signed, then the game would change. What would happen? It would go negative. Oops, what happened there? Ah, I see. You have to assign it. So, see, the other thing is that if you write an expression like this, by default, it becomes an integer. That's another thing the lab explores. If you put a literal value, what type is it? Okay, the default is int in many such cases because it, you know, overflowed that. So now, suppose I say card B equals A less than 2, okay, and then I say int B. Now it's negative because 180 overflowed. Okay. But if I say unsigned car B, then it's okay, then it's 180. Okay. Now, the other important thing is this, that rule that the bit injected from the left depends on the original signed bit. That's true if the number is signed. If it is unsigned, it will always inject zeros. So if you declare a signed, you know, implicitly variable is assigned, and you have this quantity 1011, and you shift it right by 1, you are going to get this 1 is going to come there, and the left bit injected will be a 1. Okay. Whereas if you declare the variable as unsigned, then the left bit injected will be a 0. So if you are trying to do arithmetic on numbers, use signed. If you are just using bit operations for whatever purpose you have, use unsigned, because you don't run this risk of injecting a 1 from the left. If you are just using the byte as an array of bits, then declare unsigned so that there is no overflow, there is no negative stuff, there is no one bit being injected and so on. Okay, so to do a quick summary, we reviewed integer numbers, floating point numbers, we saw most of the basic operations on them, then we looked at integers, logical conditions, Boolean conditions, and also integer types as arrays of bits, and how to do bitwise Boolean operations on those bits. Okay. One more example was left in the C code. Any questions so far? So I don't think you have ever been in this classroom for any other lecture. How many of you take other lectures here? Listen to other lectures. Is this your first semester in this room or second semester? So I have a problem with my voice. My voice doesn't work well with PA systems. So, and things work out only if, you know, the place is fairly quiet and so on. So if you're trying to protest that my voice is unclear, you have to do that distinctly and then stop protesting so that, you know, I can make some progress. Okay. So the last thing I wanted to demo is the following. So I read a number. This is also not too. Actually, this is not. So here's the only two lines you can look at. Character A is 45, and then all I'm doing is I'm stenciling A with some pattern and then printing it out. So in this case it's XOR. So let me just also print out . So this is very simple. I have one input value. I'm printing it out in binary and then I'm printing out A XORed with 55. Okay, what is 55? 55 hex looks like 0101 0101. So it's the alternating bit sequence, just as an experiment. So see what's happened here. Let me actually write down 55 as well. So what happens? The first pattern is 45. The second is 0x55. That's alternating zeros and ones. So this was one, that was one, the result was 0. This is 0, this is 0, the result is 0. This is 1, this is 0, the result is 1. Okay. So that's how XORing is done. And in this case, you shall see that unsigned should not make a difference, I hope. So it's the same number. Because XORs don't involve shifting and there is no interpretation of sign, XORs will go the same way no matter whether you declare them unsigned or signed. Once we have this values of these different types, we can declare variables. Actually, you have been seeing them from right the first lecture. You can declare a variable called Fahrenheit. You can initialize it to some value. If the value doesn't change, you can declare it to be a const. You can also declare initializer values of variables based on other variables that have already been initialized. And I, you know, spoke about why initializing and declaring variables is good. Now, one thing you need to be careful about is type conversions and the way literal values get fitted into the variables being declared. So if you say short x equals 20,000 and then you say int y equal to x, that is no problem because 20,000 fits in a short and int is only wider. So that conversion will be implicit, everything will be taken care of. But what happens if you say int x equals 40,000 and then short y equal to x? You already, some of you have seen it in the lab, what happens. So it might overflow and wrap around and so on. So you need to be careful of that. Others must be made explicit. So if you say float x equals 5.6 and then you say int y equal to x, the compiler may or may not be happy about that. So let's try this out. I will be sloppy and reuse my Java stub or something, C++ stub, or maybe we should go to float, whole bunch of stuff there from last time, but let's experiment with declarations mostly today. What else is there to be careful about? So, does this make any sense? Float, you know, if you put an int x, that's fine. If you don't, seems like the compiler is okay with it. Some could be errors. It doesn't make sense to take hello world and turn it into a floating point number, or does it? So, anytime you write something which looks absurd, you should try it out. You never know what will actually happen. So, I'm actually almost as clueless about C++ as some of you might be. So let's try this out. So let's say float, well, I can't do float x again. So let's try that. Okay, does it make any sense? All right. So it's clearly unhappy. Right. Now, if I don't even coerce it into a float and just write that, we do the same thing. Yeah. So basically, it's finding all these character sequences and finding them out of place for a float. Okay. So some things will be guarded by the program. Something as absurd as this will be guarded. But if you are converting between types which are almost compatible, strange things may happen that you can't predict. So as we saw, rounding—it's not rounding or taking a float; it's just taking the integer part of numbers. If you say float x equals 7 over 3 versus float x equals 7 over 3 dot, let's see what happens. Right, so it looks very, very similar. One dot is different. So in one case, what happened is that 7 was interpreted as an integer, 3 is an integer. Therefore, the result of slash was taken to be an integer, which was the integer part of 7 over 3. That was assigned to A. In the second case, because 3 dot looked like a floating point number, that was turned into either float or double. I have to look up which. Because the slash had one party which is higher precision than the other, the value of the whole expression was lifted to the higher precision number and the whole fractional number was assigned into B. So be very careful about the initialization issues because you might get things wrong because of just one dot. So that's a result of implicit typing. The system sees a literal string in your code and has to understand what type you mean, and it picks the least compatible type. So 3 dot can't fit in an integer, whereas 3 fits in an integer. Okay. Now, by least, I don't necessarily mean least precision, because otherwise, for 3, it might pick byte, but that doesn't happen. So after characters and other types, so the last type we'll discuss today is string. And you know, computers do a lot of fun things with strings. The whole internet is around strings. Web pages have lots of strings. When you are browsing the web, you're clicking on a link, that link is a long string, which is interpreted to mean a server name and a protocol and a path. The path is a string. Your file name is a string. So strings are everywhere. Okay. So when we said cout less than hello world was stored as an array of characters inside RAM. Okay. So to give you a pictorial description, remember RAM looks like this one-dimensional array of bytes. At some point, the string started. This was H, the next was E, then there was L, another L, and so on, until there was hello world D. And then to mark to the system that the string is over, the last character was 00 hex. Okay. So in old C and C++, that was the convention that strings will be terminated in the null character. Now, this of course is painful because who knows if someday you'd like to store a null character in your string itself. See, you declared that a string is an array of characters. All characters should be kosher. You know, all characters are legal and allowed. Why are we special casing one character and calling it the end of string marker? Because someday the user may want to store that string in the interior of a string. So as a general thumb rule in programming and software, using what's called in-band delimiters is generally a very bad idea. Because someday a user will try to use that delimiter in the code and in the string itself, and your code will break. So a more modern and better way to store strings is the string data type. And you declare that by saying string message hello world, or you can even do string message equal to hello world. Because old C and C++ had character arrays as legacy, the system was set up that the new string class and the old character array class can interact relatively smoothly. So you can take an old quoted hello world and assign it to a string, and you can also get a string back from the new string class, character class. So what can you do with strings? So string is actually internally implemented as an object, and we will see how to do object-oriented programming in C++ as the semester progresses, probably around midterm. But here are the basic operations. You don't need to understand object-oriented programming to understand what's going on here. So let's say you declared message as a data element or variable of type string, so string message. You can now say message.size, and that gives you the number of characters in the string. String does not keep any trailing null or anything like that. It independently keeps track of the number of characters in the string in a separate field. Okay, and that's much safer. You can also pull out the specific character at any specific position in the string. So you say message.at5, or like an array notation, message box 5. You get the character at position 5 in the string, starting at 0. Okay? In anything that looks like an array in C and C++, the first index is 0. It starts with 0, not 1. So you get the sixth character in the message, or the character at index 5. Okay? You can also get a substring of the given string by saying message.substr 1,3. What's that? Start at position 1 in the string and go for 3 more characters. Now, if walking forward 3 characters takes you past the original string, what will happen? You have to consult the manual. Some of these operations will throw an exception or runtime error or crash. Other operations will silently truncate. So if your string is not long enough and you walk past it, the substring will end at the original string. Okay. And others may return garbage. So again, C++ is a little unfriendly with regard to this. The Java string class is friendlier in the sense that you do anything that's fishy, it will throw an exception. So C++ may happily do things that you may not know about it for a while. So all this is implemented by calling methods on the string object, and how that is done we'll see somewhat later in the course. But you don't need to understand that to be able to use it. More string operations. You can search for characters in the string. You can say find the first occurrence of O in hello world. If the character is not found, it returns some illegal value like -1, which doesn't make sense. Or you can find the last occurrence of a character, like find last of E. You can also compare two strings in dictionary or lexicographic order. So you can, and that is done by taking two messages and saying message1 dot compare message2. And this returns an integer, which can be negative, 0, or positive. If it is 0, it means that the strings message1 and message2 are exactly equal, hello world and hello world. If message1 should appear before message2 in a dictionary or a telephone directory, then negative numbers are returned. Whereas if message1 should appear after message2, then a positive number is returned. So those are the conventions. Let's fool around a little bit with the string class to see how that works. So the very first program is extremely simple. We are just saying string message hello new line, and we are printing out the message. Fair enough. Okay. So this is just, and apart from IOStream, you now have to include the library called string so that strings are found. Now let's print out the size. The size is 6. Why is that? It's hello followed by that new line character. The new line character costs you 1 byte in Unix systems. In Windows systems, it costs you 2 bytes. So just to make life more fancy. Okay. So then we can also initialize, we can reinitialize message to another string. So the string class and character arrays are interoperable. Okay. And then you can print that out and its size, and everything changes, as you shall see. Okay. Mood Indigo with a new line will be 12 characters word. Okay. Now, I'll informally introduce a for loop, and you'll see for loop soon enough. So here I am saying, for this variable mx, which is initialized to 0, and mx has to be less than the message's size, and this is called an auto increment operator. Okay. And then I can write down the character at mx, but I also write down integer code. Okay. So at the character value as well as the integer value. So let's see what that gives us. So Mood Indigo has 12 characters in it. The first is M with bytecode 77, followed by O bytecode 111, and so on. Space has a bytecode of 32. Okay. And all this finishes. And finally, there's a new line. New line trying to print it goes to the next line. And the code of new line is 10. Okay, so that's Mood Indigo printed character by character. I can append things to other strings. So I can take Mood Indigo new line and append TechFest new line to it. And the result is Mood Indigo TechFest, one after the other. So appending is as you would expect. And finally, I'll show how to take a substring 1, 2, 3. Okay. So when I say take a substring starting at character position 1 and go for 3 characters, because it starts with Mood Indigo, I'll go to O. So this will be O and then OOD. So you find OOD here, coming from Mood Indigo like this. Okay. Now if I took something like say 5 and then take 10 characters, how will that change? So if I start at 5 and I go for 10 characters, it starts with Indigo. So this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then in going for 10 characters, it actually includes that new line between the two lines. So and then goes up to C. Okay. So that's the string class. So next we'll look at expressions and assignments. That will be next lecture.